You guys ready for our last comic? The headline of the night. He's performed in Iraq over 50 times. You may have heard him on Howard Stern. He's James Brown's brother. Give it up for Russ Brown.
Family resemblance is uncanny.
Oh, man. Well, I'm the last comedian in this Bataan Death March of Comedy. How many people are here because you love comedy? How many people are here because you're an alcoholic and they serve whiskey? I like to know my crowds. Here's a question up front. Where are the Jaeger bomb drinkers? That's very important. Okay, a couple of you. Listen, are you rational people who don't even know what a Jaeger bomb is? That's a Red Bull energy drink and booze. Yeah, I know. Who thought that up? Who wants to have all the energy to do the shit you don't normally have the motor skills for? That's a terrible idea. That's a great way to get a lot of things you wouldn't normally want, like a tattoo on your neck or a baby. You can't just laser off a baby. You can't put a cure baby over that first baby that time in Tijuana. Then I thought about it, and I came up with my own drink, and it's the most dangerous drink in the world. It's so dangerous, I don't think it should ever be made, but I'm going to give you the recipe because I'm irresponsible. It's tequila, Jack Daniels, Red Bull. I call it Punch a Cop. Drink four or five of those, I don't get hungover, but you could get bit by a police dog. Any cops here before I say anything stupid? Probably should have said that first. Any cops here? Any cops saying? Huh? Is there one? Where is he?
Right here.
Is he really? Oh, you're a cop? Woo! Are you a local cop? Yeah. Oh, shit. Listen, I don't want you to be going on again. I don't hate cops. I just hate some of the shit that you do. Maybe you don't. Maybe you're a different kind. Do you do that thing where you park across from the bar at 2 o'clock in the morning and wait for the guys to come?
No.
Does he do that, local people? They really don't. You are a good one. That's weird.
That's
a piece of unicorn. Well, that's not you. We're a bunch of the other ones. They're dicks. Because I think my living in bars. I'll come on. It's about, you ever do this? It's like 1:45 in the morning. You had a fantastic night. You walk out, you're so excited. Just before you get to your car, you look in there. He is sitting across the street in his cruiser looking at you. And you see him, and he sees you, and you know he sees you. You're sitting down and you gotta start doing that alcohol math in your head real quick. You're like, all right, 3 beers divided by 200 pounds over the course of 2.5 hours times 2 Jaeger bombs. Shit. You know, he's in there like, do it. Do it, I double dog dare you, do it. And it's like, that's bullshit. You should not be allowed to do that. That should be illegal. That's like hunting off a bait pile. You should not be allowed to do that. I don't know all the rules, but we're just scared of that. I mean, really. That's what you do to Taco Bell at 2 o'clock in the morning, which is bullshit too. You can beat the cop to Taco Bell at 2 o'clock in the morning. That would be like, save. Slide it in sideways. Nice try, Pokey. Ooh, I will see you after 4 minutes. Taco Bell is like a salt lick for drunks. Shouldn't be allowed to hunt there either. You guys are drinking. I want you to please be careful because I don't know if you guys know this, but people do a lot of dumb stuff and they blame it on the booze, and it's not the booze's fault. Like if you're a congressman or a senator, you have to be extra careful because sometimes those guys can drink themselves gay. No, it starts out easy enough, then you're tapping your toe in a bathroom somewhere. That wasn't even one guy. That was like 4 guys in one summer. That's not a fluke. That's a trend. And then celebrities are awesome because celebrities can drink themselves racist. Yeah. Does that ever happen to anybody? You have a couple of eggnogs at Christmas, you call your grandma a wop? Probably like John Mayer and the guy from the Mel Gibson, even Dog the Bounty Hunter. Remember Dog the Bounty Hunter? He had the number one show on television at the time, and he got thrown off for like 8 whole weeks. Because he got caught making racial insensitive statements when he was drunk. And people were shocked, they were outraged. Am I the only one that wasn't shocked? Am I the only one that took one look at a 54-year-old ex-con with a feathered mullet and a leather vest? Named Dog? Didn't assume he's gonna say anything smart right away, really? He only did Dixie to crack that code, honestly. And the woman in the front row goes, you know, you just said that's racist. And I was like, oh no, honey, a mullet isn't a race. That's a lifestyle choice. That comes off with scissors. That's not a race. Then she got serious. She goes, no, you don't know him. You don't know his heart. You took one look at him and you judged him. And that's judging a book by its cover. That's a form of prejudice. And you should be ashamed of yourself. And I was like, whoa. She kind of has a point. But then I thought about it. I was like, you know what? No, I'm not the only judgmental one. Especially women. Is there a woman in this room who would put her feet up in the stirrups for Dog the gynecologist? I'm the dog, the baby. What's the matter? Why are you crying? I'm obviously a gynecologist. It says so on my tattoo. I'm the D-O-G-B-Y-N. D-O-G-B-Y-N. That's an acronym joke. That's an acronym joke. Ladies, you're not the only judgmental ones, you're not. Because there isn't a man in this room who wants to get his big checkup from Richard Simmons, the proctologist. And that's not you being judgmental. That's you not wanting to get checked out by a 65-year-old man in a glittery Hooters uniform. That's the thing I don't understand about Richard. Is the man is solidly in his 60s. He still wears those little short shorts. Really? At your age? Am I the one who thinks that's a little ambitious? But, like, how old are you, officer?
42.
42? We have a... Looking for like a younger person. Every once in a while you catch like a younger person then looking at you and you're just like, listen, here's the thing about Richard Simmons and those short shorts. This is the thing that men don't understand, young men. Is that when you turn 18, your penis will never grow another inch in its life. Never. Not one inch. Never. No matter how fast you wash it or how many times you pull on it, it'll never grow another inch. Ever. But your balls. There was a race and nobody told them. And they're trying to catch up. And that's the thing. Richard is solidly into his 60s. He's doing a little short story. 60? Really? Is there like a sweating the oldies outtakes video that I don't know about? Like, and bah! And do you? We get some duct tape on Richard and Richard as soon as this, please. Furry little bungee jumpers. That's not how you sweat to the oldies. Unless maybe, hey, you know, I always thought that was a stupid title, Sweating to the Oldies, but then I thought about maybe every once in a while one of the oldies pops up. Kind of makes sense now that you think about it.
Hey, I think I saw one of the oldies.
Richard Simmons, a proctologist. I shouldn't even mention a proctologist. Women, you know how terrified men are of proctologists? I literally know men who went to combat easier than they went to the proctologist. And listen, I'm not going to sit up here and say I'm encouraging people to put things in my butt. I'm not. I don't have drunk of them yet. I'm not doing that. I'm just saying men will complain about it. They'll be like, oh, it's awful. I think he went to school on a basketball scholarship. Yeah, he's I think any man who complains to a woman, especially one who had children, about how pervasive and invasive that little thing that you have to go through is, I think a woman should be allowed to stab him in the neck with a pen. Just, you leave that in there. You don't take it out. You think about what you said. Remember who you're talking to? Do you remember that? Think about that. That's the thing, is that, you know, and men, I don't know if you know this, women aren't that sympathetic to your pain anyways, real or imagined. Can you imagine complaining to your wife, the mother of your children, about how awful you felt and violated and whatever, and they'd be like, oh, really? Man, you poor dear. That's a well-lubed finger for 30 seconds? Whoa, that sounds terrible. Yeah, how did that whole thing happen? Did he get drunk, stick it in, say it was a mistake, but could he keep it there anyways? Was it a game of just the tip? What happened? Probably said he was going to break up with you unless you let him try it at least once, huh? Yeah, tell mom all about it. Yeah, that is good. Such babies about it. They act like there's a gay button back there. Like, you're going to be in the middle of a medical procedure that could potentially save your life. And they're going to flip a switch and change everything. Like, all right. Now you're going to feel a little discomfort and a little pressure. Yeah, all right. That is uncomfortable. Yes, that is. Step one, check. Wow, that is uncomfortable. I don't know if I feel any pressure yet. I don't know if I feel it. Clang, clang, clang with the trolley. Ding, 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 ding. I'm just gonna start tap dancing and jazz hands out of the room. But I'm very sympathetic to, you know, women's, because I was there when I'm a father, and I was there when my children were born, and I'm very sympathetic when it comes to childbirth, because I'll tell you, I was in the Marine Corps, and I was completely not prepared for what I saw. They were like, here's your beautiful baby boy. I was like, ooh, well, shit. Don't you want to hold him? No, I don't. Is that one even done? That one doesn't look done. Is that a human baby that just fall asleep in a cornfield? Like, what? This is a big bombing moment. He's not going to remember this at all. You can take it with you. Heat lamp or whatever it is to make it look like a baby. Scrape that off. God, I hope that comes off. Oh, my God. It was funny, too, because, you know, how many men here, I had to cut the cord. How many men here have had to cut the cord? That was like a cool thing. Okay. Guys who have done it are the only ones who really know what I'm talking about, because guys are stupid. We think that, you know, they're letting us get involved in the thing. Oh, I'm going to be a big part of this or whatever. And for me, I'm a comedian. I'm like, I have terrible health coverage. So I was like, what's the copay on a cord cut? Oh, I can do that. I have to see about that. Well, so we think it's ceremonial, like the first pitch of a baseball game or something, you know, like we're just going to peek and then streamers and balloons, and that's not how it is. That's the guy who's done it. He'll tell you that cord has the consistency of a bike chain. You don't get to just cut that. You're like, are these lefty scissors? You gave me the scissors that won't cut hair.
I didn't do that in the hospital.
I hacked through that stupid cord, and I was sitting there like, oh my God, I just watched the baby being born. This is so crazy. And then I heard him say, now it's time to deliver the placenta. And I was like, Italian food? I love Italian food. I didn't know this delivery was catered. Man, that's... I thought you were going cheap when I had to do the thing on the court, but that's all right. Extra garlic on my placenta. And the nurse goes, no, that's where your baby's been living. I was like, what? And they push down on her belly like the Play-Doh Fun Factory. And then they pull on that cord, and out comes this purple, horrified, awful, and there's a guy whose only job in the whole world is to hover down there in a dish and catch it in a dish. He's just down there waiting. And they pushed down extra hard, and it popped out, and it hit the edge of the dish, and it fell on the floor, and I lost it. I was like, dude, that thing's just scoring over time. What is happening here? It was horrifying. I was waiting for Sigourney Weaver to come by and kill it with a flamethrower. Don't let it hear your face.
Yeah.
You know, I love true stories. I wish that those were jokes. But I hear weird stuff all the time. Perfect example. Who here's ever heard of Coco the Sign Language Gorilla? Couple? All right, couple. Listen, I'm not very many. It's a weird story, but I'm glad that a couple of people know, just so that the rest of you don't think I'm lying. Because this is 100% true story. For those of you who don't know, there's a gorilla in California that they taught sign language to, and she really took to it. And it's not like, you know, five words, like yes, no, you know, whatever. No, like 1,600 words. There's a gorilla in California. 1,600 words, you can have a full-on conversation with a gorilla. I said there's a talking monkey in California. A talking monkey. Talking monkey. You guys are like, and? What's that around here that you're not impressed by a monkey that would beat you in Scrabble? 1,600 words? Really? You don't know 1,600. That's a lot. All right, listen. Your apathy was well deserved because the talking gorilla is literally the most normal part of this very true story. So, before you can talk to the gorilla, and this is 100% true, I don't know why, before you can go in and talk, man or woman, it doesn't make a difference, but before you go in, before she'll talk to you, you have to bare your breast. I don't know why. It's a talking gorilla thing. I don't know. I think it's a trust or whatever, but you have to bare your breast. And there was a woman, this is true, who went into the preserve, and she learned sign language, and she wanted to speak to Coco, and at the last minute, they were like, by the way, you have to bare your breast. And she was like, what? And they're like, no, it's true, we're really sorry, you gotta bury your breast. And she was like, do I look stupid? I have a master's degree, okay? Is this some sort of joke you put this on YouTube? Is this some sort of you're hazing me? No, listen, do I look stupid? No, you don't understand. No, you don't understand, okay? I'm not gonna do this. You must be out of your mind. You think it's gonna be some sort of gag, you're gonna watch this on video playback, and your friends, you think this is, I don't care if it's a talking monkey, I don't care if it's a fly, I'm not gonna bare my breast with a monkey. And the guy was like, whatever, go ahead, go. So she went in, she wouldn't bare her breast, and the gorilla wouldn't talk to her. So she sued for sexual harassment and hostile work environment. I said that they're suing a gorilla in California in court. They have brought litigation. I'm not making this up. Okay, that's not the weird part of the story. That's not. The weird part of the story is, and this is true, the attorney for the woman went on Good Morning America. You can Google it.
Stop.
No, he went on Good Morning America, and he looked straight into a camera that he knew was on and said, as it sits right now, we don't have any plans to put Coco on the stand. It said that a guy who went to college said, I do not intend to swear a gorilla under oath. Who doesn't want to see that? Can you imagine? How awesome would that be? Can you imagine if it was some like really hyper-aggressive cross-examination, like, Coco the Sign Language Gorilla, did you realize that you were creating a hostile work environment for my client? No. I'm a monkey. Coco the Sign Language Gorilla, did you realize that according to states and statute of the state of California, that you were sexually harassing my client? I'm like, no, I'm a monkey. What kind of jackass would try and sue a monkey? Woo! I should throw a poop at you. Does anybody here speak sign language? Anybody, even a little? Oh, man, okay, well, if you did, you would recognize that I learned real sign language for that joke. Because I'm a professional, and I don't want one of you guys to go, oh, that's not even the sign for that. That old story is probably made up. And if you want to learn, you can learn the same way I did. I learned at the Online Sign Language Academy. It's a very true website. It's called the Online Sign Language Academy. You put in the word that you want. Like, this is for jackass, the two ears, and this is for Sue, like a car crash. And a very pleasant-looking person will say, jackass. And it's Sue. And it's pretty awesome. But I got to the end of the joke, I throw poop at you, and they didn't have it. Yes, I know, I was pretty mad. But then, this is true, they have a suggestion box. It's true. What it is any word that you want that's not in the library, you put it in the suggestion box, and they guarantee within 24 hours you'll get an email of a very pleasant-looking person doing a little sign within 24 hours, and then they add that word to the library, thus increasing our collective knowledge. It's like, that's awesome. Tier Online Sandwich Academy. Russ Brown here. Love the website. Found it a little lacking. I didn't know how to say, I throw poop at you. Thanks in advance, Russ Brown. 24 hours goes by, 48 hours goes by, nothing, no response. I was like, that's weird. It says 24 hours, but Dear Online Sandwich Academy, it's Russ Brown again. I know you got my last email. I'm probably very busy. It's no big deal. I just need to know how to say, I throw poop at you. Your friend, Russ Brown. 24 more hours goes by, 48 hours goes by, no response. Now I'm pissed. Now I'm mad. Now I know they're ignoring me. It's twice. So now I got to send an angry email. Isn't that weird? Because you don't want to overdo it, but you want to make sure that they know that you're serious. So what do you say? I was like, ooh, the silent treatment. I should have guessed. You can't tell the Online Sign Language Academy that they're giving you the silent treatment. You can't. They will get pissed. They did. You laughed. They were furious. They called me. They called me. I was so surprised. I knew it was them because I was like, hello? And they were like, no, 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 You can laugh. It's okay. You can laugh. If you were going to hell, you were already going. It's okay. So, it's not going to throw you over the edge. You don't have to be offended. It's not like you're going to hear that joke. You're fine. You don't have to worry about that. Oh, you guys got a quiet. Oh, okay. Well, that's the thing. Here's the thing. Let me just soapbox for a second. I love that I would tell that joke. And sometimes people get offended because I say something about the deaf people. Here's the thing. The reason why I really know sign language is I have deaf cousins. And here's the thing, if you don't know anybody with a disability, is the last thing they want to be treated like is a person with a disability. And men, we say awful things to each other all day long at work. We're terrible, and we joke around with each other, and we make fun of each other, and that's the spice of life. And when you don't treat a person with a disability like a regular person, you take that bit of humanity away from them. And you know, my cousin, for all the people who got offended, my cousin has come to the shows, and he's never been offended at that joke. Not because it's not offended, and not because it's not offensive. It is offensive, but when I get to the offensive part, I cover my mouth. Because he reads lips. He's like, what did he say? We always do that. I always miss that. I don't know why is everyone laughing. Why is everyone not? He always covers his mouth. I don't get it. See? If you'd have laughed at the first joke, I would have never had to invent my gut cover. I made him up to prove a point. I made him up to prove a point. All of us have learned something. Hope you're happy. You made me bring him into existence. Just for that. Before I get out of here, I have a CD that I saw. It's my first album. It's an hour long. I don't think anything that I've done tonight. Yeah, it's an hour. Yeah, most headliners do an hour. That's what normally shows will have like an hour. We have a bunch of comics tonight. It's the first night, so I want to make sure we have a good show for you guys. But it's an hour long, and I don't sell it. I give it away. I run a charity I spent a lot of time over in the Middle East, and I formed it for veterans with PTSD, traumatic brain injury. I give it away. It's free. It's free or donation. If you want to give me money, I put it towards a charity. If you don't, that's completely fine. I will give it to you for free. I'll even sign it, which I'm pretty sure reduces its value. But I do that afterwards. And before I forget, please put your hands together for the waitstaff tonight. They've been working very hard. This is their Halloween. Very, very important for them. They're working on Halloween so you guys can stay good and drunk. And listen, you know, again, if you guys have a couple extra bucks, I don't want a soapbox for the waitstaff, but if you guys have a couple of extra bucks, I got to talk to some of these girls before the show, and I've been here a couple of times before, and so I kind of got to know a few of them, and I'll tell you, if you got a couple of extra bucks, just slide. It might not mean a lot to you, but it means a lot to them. And I'm not saying that they're whatever, but I'm just saying that if you follow these girls home, you would find trailers filled with illegitimate children. Just women, just dull, gray, tin pinatas filled with dirty-faced, unwashed, barefoot children. If you could just give a couple of bucks, please, you could put some Crocs on the dirty, unwashed feet of some very neat children. Please. Do you guys want to hear? You guys want to hear one more? I'll do one more. I got a couple. I'll lead you to where I like doing comedy. You get to talk about a lot of things that, it's a good cathartic release to talk about things that bug you and to find different things. But it's hard to find a topic that we can all mutually agree, to hate, to kind of pick on. But I found one topic that works everywhere. No matter where I go, you can always find a group of people who hate contractors. Are there any contractors here tonight? Rough framers, drywallers, plumbers? Those fuckers never show up. Really? What do you do? You're a contractor for real? Oh, concrete, you're probably on the clock right now. I'm going to take a short five. So really, you're a concrete guy? Well, I'm sure you're very good, but I hire the dumbest ones exclusively. I had a drywaller. I hate drywallers are the worst. I hate drywallers so bad I won't let my kid watch Bob the Builder. Nope. He's a bad influence. Now go play Grand Theft Auto. I hire the worst ones. I swear. This is true. I had a drywaller come out of my basement, look me dead in the face, and tell me that the pyramids were built by an ancient union contractor builder. I was like, yeah, you can definitely tell it was a union job. Of course, the original design was a cube. Gradually over time, they collectively bargained to do less and less and less. There it is, I solved the mystery. Pricks, I hate him, I do. I hate him so bad, and my comedy was like, man, you're making fun of contractors, afraid to write one of the audience. Aren't you afraid to take offense at what you say? Aren't you a little nervous? You can't. I was like, listen, it's not some kind of tough guy or anything, but what's the worst case scenario? What's the scenario? He's going to jump out behind the parked car after the show and be like, come on, Mr. Funny Man, right now. He's a concrete guy. You know, we don't mean right now. Right now. It's raining. Whiskey's here, you're going to show tomorrow bright and early about noon. I'm afraid of a guy you have to meet who's only going to half kick your ass for straight time. I mean, really. One more story I'll tell you. And this is a true story. I don't have a joke for this. It's a thing that really happened to me. I wish it wasn't. Who here's ever been to Hillsdale, Michigan? Anyone? A couple of you? Okay. I don't always play really nice clubs with like nice ceilings and lighting. I don't always do that, okay? The life of a comic is pretty bad. We have to do what they call road gigs. And a typical road gig was this thing in Hillsdale. And it was like 40 apathetic drunks who have been drinking since noon, whatever. And they had just, in a room that sat 150, they had 40 drunks, the big aisle up the middle. And here's the way road comedy works. You have to do your time. It's an hour and a half show, and you got to do your time. And if you don't do your time, then you're a breach of contract, and they don't have to pay you, and they love to not pay you. So it was me and a buddy, and we were on the road, and I was headlining, and he was featured. And he goes up, and he's got to do a half an hour, and I got to do an hour. And he goes up, and they hate him. Like, they hate everything about him. Everything he says, the crowd just turns on him. You suck! You ain't funny! Queer! Suck! You ain't funny! Never said a funny thing in your life! Suck! And he's trying. He's like, yeah, what is the thing? Here's a weird one. And they're like, no, you know what's weird? When you suck, which is all the time. You suck! You queer! Suck! No one's laughing except me. I'm in the back, dying. I'm dying. I'm wheezing. I'm laughing so hard. Emma, so he's on stage, dying. For like 6-7 minutes, and I hear him go, coming to the stage, your headliner. And I was like, what? Oh, yeah. Now, not only is the crowd out of control, but now I got to do his time plus my time. I'm leading the crowd. So I was like, and he takes me like, ha, sorry about it, Mike. Hang on. So I go up and I'm doing my little show, and I finally get everybody on my side. I get everybody. There's the aisle way up in the middle, except I got this one guy right here. I got this one guy who drank himself like narcolepsy and Tourette's. Like, he would drift in and out of sleep, and then he'd wake up and go, "Yay, fine, clear." And as a comedian, we know how to deal with hecklers. You just want to like jump on him and say something witty, but then he's asleep, so it's like, don't wake the baby. That kind of thing. You know, just glad he's out. And he would, I would be right in the middle, so he would just pop up, "Suck, queer, suck." So I'm just trying to work through it. I'm just ignoring him, and the guy on the other side of the aisle is losing it. He's getting all angry, and he can tell it. He's trying to ignore it. Finally, he just snaps, and he looks across the aisle, and he goes, "Hey, I got an idea. Why don't you shut up?" And this guy springs to life, and in perfect English says, "Why don't you make me?" So this guy says, "We won't step outside." And this guy says, "We don't have to step outside. We can do this right here, right now." And then he stood up, and I was like, "Oh." And then here's the thing. The next line, I can't even write this. This guy, the drunk guy, looks at the other drunk guy and says, "There ain't nothing between us except air and opportunity." Which in Hillsdale means we're fixing the scrap. So this guy is just jaw-jacking. "Oh, come on, man, you think you're so bad, man? You ain't so bad, come on, man." This guy's just standing there looking at him, and without saying a word, he drops back into a perfectly balanced fighting stance. And I was like, that dude's about to get his ass kicked. Man, I have never wanted to see a guy get kicked in the face so bad in my life. So this guy, he sees him do that, and he's in the alcoholic fighting stance. He's got his chin out. He's like, "Come on, man, you ain't so bad. Come on, man, I'm taking bigger dumps than you. I ain't afraid of your Kung Fu, Jiu-Jitsu, nothing, man. You think you're a badass, man, I'll whoop your ass. I'll tell you, man, I'll show you a badass." This guy, without saying a word, he's just staring through him. He throws the hardest leg kick I've ever seen in my life. And he goes, whoosh. He kicked that dude in his leg so hard that it flew off. His fake leg flew off. It came out of his pant leg and landed under a table over here. And the guy who kicked him, he was drunk enough, I think he thought he did. It's like when you hit an exploding golf ball for just a second, you're like, "No, we're gonna hold with that one." Because he kicked him, and the guy goes down like a house of cards, but then he didn't follow it up. You know, he wanted to murder him a second before, and then he's just sitting there frozen like, "I kicked a man in his face so hard." And then the guy, he hits the ground, he got kicked in plastic, so he didn't learn any lesson. There was no pain transfer information. So he's on the ground, he's still talking smack. He's like the Black Knight from Monty Python. He says, "I thought we was going to fight. I didn't know you was going to kick me in the leg like a queer." And this dude is standing there going, "I must kick really hard." And this guy says the best thing ever. He says, "When I get my leg back on, I'm going to whip your ass." And so he rolls over and starts tripodding it over to the table so he can fish his leg out from underneath the table. He's talking smack the whole time. He's under the table like, "Man, when I get my leg back on, I'm going to whoop somebody's ass. I'll tell you what, you think this is funny?" Finally, two bouncers show up and they grab him. One grabs him by each arm. He didn't even get his leg back on. He's still holding it in his hand. Just a shiny shin bone and a shoe. He's still got it in his head. And they're dragging him out and he's screaming the whole way, "This is not over. When I get my leg back on, I'm going to whoop somebody's ass. I tell you what, this is not over. I'm gonna be outside. I've been waiting on y'all. Y'all think this is funny? I've been whooping everybody's ass. My boobs gonna ride. I'm whooping everybody. This is bullshit. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. When I get my head." Shut the door. In 1 second, everyone in the room looks straight at me. What do you say to that? I was just sitting there like, okay. I always thought that a one-legged man in an ass-kicking competition was a figure of speech. Apparently, you can get that done in Hillsdale. You guys have been a fantastic audience. Thank you very much. Peace out. I have to show.
November 13th, there's a free show here. Come check it out. Amateur Up and Coming Comics. The show is free. The winner gets $250. It's going to be a fun time. It's free, so that guy likes it. That's what matters. Other than that, also we have a party down here. You guys hear about that?
No.
Oh, yeah. After this, we're kicking it off. We're partying. We got a DJ over there.
Woo!
Yeah. What's your DJ name?
There's a DJ breaker
down here. We're getting wild with DJ breakers. It's going to be a good time. And we have a costume contest. I think the winner gets $200.
No.
So stick around. You've had that face mask on the whole time. That's commitment right there. Your face is going to be sweating, breathing your own breath back in your face. Wow. That's commitment. So if you're thinking about voting for a guy, that's a committed guy right there. Another thing is, make sure... Give it up for real quick, Russ Brown, Steve Lynn, let me hear it.
Yeah,
man. Dave Brown Jr., your staff has been working hard over there. I've had a great time, guys. I appreciate you guys all coming out tonight. Yeah. Stick around, drink some more, have a good time. We're going to hit this DJ off. Thanks a lot for coming, guys. Have a great night.